our hearing topic today is toxic coal ash, adverse health effects from the Puerto Rico plant and options for plant closure. Under Committee Rule 4F, any oral opening statements at hearings are limited to the chair and the ranking member or their designees. This will allow us to hear from our witnesses sooner and help members keep to their schedules. Therefore, I ask unanimous consent that all other member opening statements be made part of the hearing record if they are submitted to the clerk by 5 p.m. today or the close of the hearing, whichever comes first. Hearing no objection, so ordered. Without objection, the chair may also declare a recess subject to the call of the chair. As described in the notice, statements, documents, or motions must be submitted to the electronic repository at hnrcdocs@mail.house.gov. Additionally, please note that as with in-person meetings, members are responsible for their own microphones. As with our in-person meetings, members can be muted by staff only to avoid inadvertent background noise. Finally, members or witnesses experiencing technical problems should inform committee staff immediately. With that, I'm going to proceed with my opening statement. When AES opened Puerto Rico's only coal-powered plant in 2002, there were about 100 cases of cancer per year in the nearby city of Guayama. Within a year, cases rose 50%. Today, roughly one out of every 10 people in Guayama has been diagnosed with cancer. One out of every four has cardiovascular disease. One out of every three has respiratory disease. In short, the coal plant is killing the people of Guayama. And the cause appears to be coal ash, a coal byproduct that looks like fine gray sand and contains toxic chemicals like arsenic, chromium, and molybdenum. 20 years ago, when the plant was built, operators said the ash could be mixed with water and sold as fill for construction projects. Perhaps unsurprisingly, there was more ash than there was a commercial market. So AES has to dispose of the dust in landfills, but the options are limited. AES has tried dumping coal ash at sites in the Dominican Republic and in Florida, but the local communities rebelled. Now, the only place willing to accept AES's coal ash is a site in Chesser Island, Georgia. And that site has led to entirely new problems. Just 3 months ago, a barge carrying ash to Georgia ran aground off the coast of Florida, leaking 9,000 tons of waste into the ocean. Meanwhile, a toxic ash pile sits outside the plant. Residents wipe dust from their counters and windows multiple times a day. They drink contaminated water, breathe contaminated air, and suffer from rare diseases. The only way to address these problems is to close the plant. That's what the community wants, and in fact, it is what AES wants. Only they don't get to decide. AES runs the plant for LUMA, L-U-M-A. A private company that operates the grid, and PREPA, the public company that owns the grid. PREPA and LUMA can't do anything without approval from both the FOMB and PREB, who are respectively their fiscal and power regulators. PREPA and LUMA say the plant is necessary. They say it's cheap and needed for baseload. But evidence suggests that neither of those assertions is correct. The Department of Energy found that Puerto Rico's potential rooftop solar output is four times that of its residential electricity consumption. Using PREPA's own data, independent analysts found that rooftop solar with battery storage could replace the plant's output reliability and at low cost. Even PREPA's own study, heavily weighted in favor of the power company, found they could close this plant right away without any harm to the grid, and of course with tremendous benefit to the people of Puerto Rico. We must close this plant, and we need to do it as quickly as possible. I thank PREPA for being here today to help us understand how we do that. Unfortunately, LUMA refused to attend. They claim to have little input on the future of the plant, even though they are in charge of writing detailed plans for the island's electrical system. And even though those plans will include divestment from several power plants in Puerto Rico. My first goal here today is to understand who was responsible for closing this plant. If in fact LUMA has little input on the future of the plant, then I look forward to hearing from PREPA about options. If PREPA cannot speak to this issue without LUMA's input, then I look forward to hearing from LUMA under subpoena if necessary. The longer we play these games, the more coal ash the plant will produce, and the more the people of Guayama are going to suffer. My second goal in this hearing is to tell the stories of the people to help bring attention to a clear case of environmental injustice. We are talking today about coal ash because this subcommittee is responsible for oversight related to Puerto Rico. But there are dozens, if not hundreds, of places just like Guayama all over the United States, places where polluters turn a blind eye to the suffering they are causing in local communities and communities of color in particular. So while this hearing is about a particular coal ash plant, I hope it will be a reminder that corporate accountability, government oversight, and clean energy are universal needs. The chair now recognizes the ranking member for any opening statement he wishes to make.
Thank you, Chairwoman. After Hurricane Maria, Puerto Rico experienced a historic blackout. It took 11 months for all 1.5 million customers to be reconnected to the power grid. Hurricane Maria is just one of the many natural disasters to strike the island in recent memory. As Puerto Rico works to recover and rebuild, it is crucial for the island to maintain reliable, baseload, affordable electricity. The AES coal plant is one of Puerto Rico's most reliable sources of energy. As David Owens noted in his written testimony, in most years, the AES coal plant achieves a capacity factor of over 85%. Additionally, it provides the most affordable source of energy on the island. Yet the majority has convened this hearing to discuss prematurely closing this plant, which plays a crucial role in keeping the lights on in Puerto Rico. Now, some may advocate for the coal plant's immediate closure. It's not just that simple. I think we can all agree that we want Puerto Rico to have reliable and affordable energy. Right now, that is achieved by using an all-the-above energy approach, with fossil fuels providing the most dependable baseload energy. Immediately closing the coal plant would jeopardize the stability of Puerto Rico's grid and increase the cost for all the island's inhabitants and citizens. That's why Puerto Rico's government has already determined transitioning away from coal-generated electricity on the island by the beginning of 2028, rather than an immediate shutdown. We receive no indication that the AES plans to deviate from that law or ignore the deadline. Further, the Puerto Rican government relies on the operation of the AES coal plant, which created its integrated resource plan, which guides the island's energy transition to meet its renewable energy goals. For this plan to be successful, meaning electricity remains affordable and reliable, sudden unexpected changes to the baseload energy supply cannot occur. The early closure of the AES plant would create instability, which would hamper the island's ability to continue its recovery efforts. It goes without saying that reliable energy is a prerequisite for businesses to thrive, which is needed to rebuild Puerto Rico's economy. The reality is today, renewable energy does not have the ability to provide comparable levels of energy baseload power compared to the AES plant. Even as Puerto Rico phases out coal generation energy, it will still have to rely heavily on other fossil fuels like natural gas. According to the U.S. Energy Information Administration, renewables only generated 2.5% of the island's electricity for the fiscal year 2020. In comparison, petroleum plants generated almost half of the electricity, natural gas generated 29% of the electricity, and coal generated 19% of the electricity. More advancements need to be made for renewable energy to be a viable provider of more of the island's electricity. As Puerto Rico searches for other dependable sources of baseload energy, there are other examples of clean energy that provide a reliable substitute for reliably coal produced. One such example is modular nuclear energy. Modular nuclear energy is capable of providing carbon-free baseload power with a capacity factor in the mid to high 90% range. That stability is what makes the grid secure capable of hosting other intermittent power supplies. Another factor for consideration of any premature closure of the AES plant is the legal constraints. AES has a contract with PREPA through the end of 2027. Prematurely terminating the contract would require PREPA to compensate AES, a cost which would be passed on to the citizens of Puerto Rico. Puerto Ricans could not only face the increased cost of energy, but also essentially foot the bill. In regards to the issue of fly ash, I would like to submit for the record an article from the Green Building Law highlighting Marin County, California's efforts at mandating low carbon concrete. Submit this for the record. You're on mute.
So without objection, so ordered.
Yeah, highlighting Marin County, California's effort at mandating low carbon concrete. This article highlights the importance of beneficial use of fly ash to decarbonize our cement process. Somehow, fly ash concrete is good enough for Marin County in California to mandate, but the beneficial use for rebuilding Puerto Rico isn't. Finally, as I close, for Puerto Rico to recover, it needs reliable energy right now. AES plays a key role in meeting that need. As the AES plant continues to provide energy, it should ensure it is complying with all federal and local regulations. In a statement submitted for the record, AES expressed the seriousness in which it approached meeting those safety standards. I hope AES meets the standards set by the U.S. government in Puerto Rico so that it can continue to provide a crucial source of energy in a safe manner. Despite the majority's disdain for fossil fuels, Puerto Rico illustrates the critical role they play in ensuring people have access to reliable, affordable, and inexpensive energy. It is irresponsible to advocate for a position that would undermine the island's access to dependable electricity, especially as they work to recover and rebuild their economy. With that, I yield back.
Thank you very much. Now I will introduce our witnesses. Mr. Alberto Colon is a member of the group Comunidad Guaymesa Unida por Tu Salud, or Guayama Community United for Health in Puerto Rico. Mr. David Owens is the vice chairman of the board for the directors of the Puerto Rico Electric Power Authority, or PREPA. Dr. Gerson Jimenez is a doctor of internal medicine in Guayama, Puerto Rico. And Mr. Alex Epstein, founder and president of the Center for Industrial Progress. And Ms. Ruth Santiago is a community and environmental attorney from Salinas, Puerto Rico. Let me remind the witnesses that under our committee rules, they must limit their oral statements to 5 minutes, but their entire statement will appear in the hearing record. When you begin, the timer will begin and it will turn orange when you have 1 minute remaining. I recommend that members and witnesses use stage view so that they may pin the timer to their screen. After your testimony is complete, please remember to mute yourself to avoid any inadvertent background noise. I will allow the entire panel to testify before we move to questioning of the witnesses. The chair notes that some of our witnesses are participating with the assistance of an interpreter. To ensure that members are able to hear from the witnesses, I will allow those witnesses to present their opening statement under the 5 minute rule and will provide the translator 5 minutes so we can hear the translation. This practice is under the chair's right of recognition as described in committee rule 4A. I also ask that members addressing these witnesses pause every few sentences to allow the interpreters to translate their questions. The chair now recognizes Mr. Colon to offer his testimony.
Buenos días a la representante Kay Porch y a los representantes del subcomité de investigaciones. Mi nombre es Alberto Colón. Soy residente de la comunidad Miramar de Guayama, Puerto Rico. Es una de las comunidades más afectadas y cercanas a la planta de generación a base de la quema de carbón. He vivido en esta comunidad por más de 20 años y he visto cómo se el deterioro de la salud de mis vecinos y familiares por la exposición a altos niveles de metales pesados que se encuentran en las cenizas de carbón. Tenemos esta contaminación por tres vías: aire, tierra y agua. Aire, porque aquí en Puerto Rico los vientos soplan del este al noreste y la planta queda al este de la comunidad, por lo que los vientos soplan todo el particulado de ceniza a nuestra comunidad y comunidades aledañas e incluso a pueblos cercanos.
Good morning, Chairman Porter and members of the committee. My name is Alberto Colon and I live in the Miramar community in Guayama, Puerto Rico. Miramar is one of the closest communities to the AES coal plant and one of the most impacted by its activity. I have lived in this community for over 20 years and I have seen my neighbors and relatives' health deteriorate due to the exposure to heavy metals present in coal ash. This contamination is present in the air, the land, and the water. I mentioned the air because here in Puerto Rico, winds blow from east to northwest and the coal plant lies east of us. So the wind blows all these particles into our community, the surrounding communities, and even further into nearby towns.
Tierra, porque AES ha depositado más de 2 millones de toneladas alrededor de la isla y muchas de ellas están bajo tierra y agua, ya que es un efecto colateral de haber enterrado la ceniza, ya que aquí se suple muchísimas comunidades de pozos y este pozo se suple del acuífero del sur. La misma AES realizó un estudio a un pozo localizado en sus instalaciones y esto reflejó que estaban contaminados. En el 2016 y 2018, la Escuela de Salud Pública, Recinto Universitario de Puerto Rico, realizó un estudio en la comunidad, el cual tenía la intención de saber la incidencia de enfermedades en esta comunidad. Estas enfermedades incluyen cáncer, enfermedades cardíacas y pulmonares, entre otras. En el 2018, este estudio reflejó un alza de más de un 50%, específicamente en el cáncer.
The land is also polluted because AES has left over 2 million tons of ashes around the island under the soil and water, and many communities rely on that water, which comes from the southern aquifer. A study carried out by AES of some of the wells in their facilities concluded they were contaminated. In 2016 and 2018, the School of Public Health of the University of Puerto Rico conducted a study in the community to determine the incidence of diseases such as cancer and heart and respiratory problems, among others. In 2018, the study showed cancer had increased over 50%.
Directamente relacionada con la exposición de las cenizas de carbón. Cuando comenzó el COVID en el 2000, hubo muchísima preocupación, ya que sabemos que el COVID es una de las enfermedades que ataca el sistema respiratorio y es uno de los más afectados que se ve por la quema de carbón en la comunidad. Esto podría provocar entonces un mayor riesgo de contraer el COVID. No tan solo hemos visto el deterioro de la salud en la comunidad, sino que también hemos visto un gran cambio en el ambiente. Hay muchos frutos que han dejado de desarrollarse. La pesca, que inclusive pues yo soy, me gusta la pesca, soy pescador, la pesca ya no es como antes, ahora es mínimo lo que se puede pescar en la bahía. El mangle en la comunidad se encuentra justo al lado de AES y se ha secado casi por completo. Es una lástima ver cómo esta empresa ha afectado en nuestra comunidad. El gobierno no quiere hacer nada por ayudarnos.
This is directly related to exposure to coal ash. At the onset of the COVID pandemic in 2020, there was a lot of concern since we knew the virus attacks the respiratory system, which is one of the most affected by the burning of coal in the community, leaving the person even more vulnerable to COVID. However, it's not just the health of the community that's been impacted. We've also seen a big change in our environment. A lot of fruit stopped growing. Fishing, and I myself, I'm a fisherman, I love fishing, is not like before. Catch in the bay is minimal now, and the community mangrove, which is right next to AES, has dried up almost completely. It's a shame to see how this company has affected everything in our community, and yet the government doesn't want to do anything to help us.
Se han hecho múltiples manifestaciones, reuniones, conferencias de prensa, tratando de que se escuche la voz del pueblo y que se haga justicia por todo esto que hemos perdido. en el proceso y por todo aquello que hoy día batallan con alguna enfermedad la cual está relacionada con la exposición y la quema de carbón. Esperamos que nos escuchen y puedan ayudarnos con esta enorme situación que vivimos en Puerto Rico.
There have been several protests, meetings, and press conferences to try and make the voices of the people heard and bring justice to all of those we lost in the process and all of those who are currently fighting a disease brought on by exposure to coal burning. We hope you will hear us and help us with this huge issue we have in Puerto Rico.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes Mr. David Owens for his 5 minutes for his testimony.
Can you hear me?
Mr. Owens, I believe you're still on mute.
Yeah, I'm trying to get off of mute.
We can now hear you, sir. Go ahead.
Okay, great. Good morning. And thank you for this opportunity to appear before this committee. My name is David Owens, as was indicated. I'm the vice chair of the Puerto Rican Electric Power Authority. You know, PREPA, we certainly do appreciate the interest in this committee to continue to understand the status of our restoration and transformation of the Puerto Rico electric grid. The focus is to build the electric system back better with a focus on reliability, resilience, clean energy, affordability, and customer centricity. We also sincerely appreciate the committee's interest in PREPA's ongoing efforts to replace the legacy fossil generating plants, including the AES coal-fired plant. Now, under Puerto Rican law, we have to comply with an integrated resource plan, which is produced by the Energy Bureau of Puerto Rico. And that plan contemplates that the AES coal-fired plant will be retired in 2027. That plan also contemplates that we have a very aggressive effort to moving to renewable technologies. Let me give you an example of that. Starting in 2021, we've issued an RFP for the procurement of 1,000 megawatts of renewable energy and 500 megawatts of energy storage. Several weeks ago, we got the responses. Over 70 respondents have expressed an interest in helping us supply renewables. We call that tranche one. The goal is by 2025 to have 3,750 megawatts of renewable technologies, as well as 1,500 megawatts of battery backup. And that's very, very important to understand. Now let's talk about what happens with respect to these fulfillment of these tranches. And I indicated today we have 70 interests that are seeking to provide renewable technologies to the island. We will issue a new RFP in August for a second set of renewable technologies. So we're moving aggressively. We're in the process of evaluating at least its first tranche of renewable technologies. And that evaluation will look at the feasibility of whether those projects meet the requirements. It will look to some significant degree whether there's technical feasibility to integrate those technologies. And it will look at the viability of those financial developers to see if they in fact can build those facilities. Let's assume that all of that takes place very rapidly. Then the soonest time that we can see that new renewables will be put on the island would be 24 months. So if we look at today, that's basically saying at the beginning of the end of 2023 or the beginning of 2024. That would be 1,000 megawatts of renewable technologies and 500 megawatts of battery backup. I said there's a second tranche. There's actually six tranches. So in August, we will issue another RFP for renewables for another 1,000 megawatts and 500 megawatts of battery backup. That second tranche, similarly, even on an expedited basis, will probably take 2 years to construct. So what's my point? My point is that renewable technologies will not be able to be integrated into the grid for at least 2 years. And even those technologies in the first tranche were not sufficient to replace the baseload plan that AES, baseload energy that AES is providing. I said that one of our goals in our building the system back better is to make sure that it's affordable and make sure that the energy is reliable and to make sure that the system is resilient. So let me kind of speak to those areas. It was already mentioned that the AES plant is a base load power plant. Let me make a distinction between a base load power plant and a renewable power plant. A base load power plant is available 24/7. The AES plant has been available what we call a capacity factor of 85%. A renewable project has a capacity factor of 25%. I'll be very simplistic here. So 85% of the time, the base load plant is available. 25% of the time, the renewable plant is available. That's why you need a lot of renewables to replace a base load plant. And more importantly, the renewable needs battery backup. When the sun isn't shining and the wind isn't blowing, you don't produce energy from those renewable resources. So you need battery backup. The battery backup is for 4 hours, not 24 hours. And so obviously it suggests if we're interested in keeping the lights on, if we're interested in having resiliency, if we have bad weather events, it's very, very important that we have base load capacity. Or let me say it differently. It's very important if we're moving to renewables, we have sufficient renewables to accommodate all these weather changes and energy storage to accommodate when a renewable project isn't available, that the energy storage, which is backup, is available. So that's really the fundamental point that we're dealing with here. Can you accelerate the development of renewable technologies? We're finding that out as we're looking at these RFPs that have come in. Can we accelerate it? In the best interest, and I've been actively involved in renewable technologies. I'm a renewable advocate for many years, and it takes about 2 years in order to complete those projects. The other thing is your electricity grid needs to be able to accommodate it. So you need to modernize your electricity grid to integrate these technologies. LUMA is rebuilding our grid, is seeking to modernize the grid so it can accommodate these renewable technologies. That's not going to happen overnight.
Mr. Owens, your time has expired for testimony.
Okay,
so if
thank
you have
you.
A final sentence, I'll allow you to finish. But
yes, I do. We're moving aggressively in our program to improve reliability, resiliency, clean energy, and customer centricity. I look forward to your questions. Thank you.
Thank you so much. The chair now recognizes Dr. Jimenez for 5 minutes to testify.
Can you see us?
I can see and hear you. Go ahead.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning, Chair Porter, Ranking Member Gosar, Vice Ranking Member Moore, and all distinguished members of this subcommittee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify today about the adverse effect of coal burning in Guayama, Puerto Rico. My name is Gerson Jimenez Castañón, and I am a physician specialized in internal medicine and have been here for the past 45 years. Today, I come before you in the support of the potential closure of the AAS Corporation coal plant in Guayama, Puerto Rico. From 2002 to present day, the AES Corporation Applied Energy System coal plant burns coal in Guayama to produce electricity. This plant is in an area very close to several neighboring communities and a few miles away from the city of Guayama. We know that the ashes, a result of burning of coal, contain metals and radioactive isotopes, which are well known to negatively affect all living beings, plants, and animals. Some of those toxic products are arsenic, mercury, lead, selenium, boron, cadmium, and cobalt. A study published in September 2015 by Duke University, a private university in Durham, North Carolina, found that the emission radioactivity from coal ash was 5 to 10 times more intense than that emitted from coal before burning. Medical doctors have long known that exposure to radiation can induce formation of various types of cancer and congenital deformities. Medical doctors who work in the southeast area of Puerto Rico have noticed that since the AES Corporation began operating in Guayama, there has been a significant increase in diseases of the respiratory tract, urinary tract, as well as a significant increase in the diagnosis of various types of cancer. Here are some examples. Between 1990 and 2000, the incidence rate of new annual cancers diagnosis was 103.3 cases per year. 8 years after the AES Corporation coal plant began operating, 2002, a significant increase in annual cancer diagnosis was reported. From 2010 to 2014, the average number of new cancer cases rose to 169.4 per year, almost 64% increase. This is a very significant finding. Every month, the pathology department of the hospital where I work reports the results of the pathological studies. Normally, between 2% to 5% of the reports result with a diagnosis of cancer. During 2020, 10 of the 12 months reports reflected figures above 5% of cancer diagnosis in the southeastern region of Puerto Rico. This is also very significant. In 2016, the School of Public Health of the University of Puerto Rico Medical Science Campus carried out a comparative study between a city distant from AES Corporation coal plant, Fajardo, a city in the eastern region of Puerto Rico, and the city of Guayama, where the plant is located. The selected communities have similar characteristics in their population. The incidence rate of the evaluated diagnosis was found to be much higher in Guayama than in Fajardo. 2 years later, in 2018, the same study was repeated, and it was found that the health condition of the residents of Guayama had deteriorated greatly compared to the previous study. I have sent a copy of these cited studies to you. The results of the studies reviewed here make me think that there is a relationship between the contamination caused by AES Corporation and the deterioration in the health of the residents of Guayama and adjacent towns. I have participated in several public hearings in municipal legislature as well as the Legislative Assembly of Puerto Rico. I have requested the government conduct additional studies of the adverse effect of contamination caused by the AES Corporation coal plant on Puerto Rico's southeastern residents. Thank you for your time and your consideration on an issue that is crucial for the health and well-being, not only in my patients, but all the residents in Guayama, Puerto Rico. I will gladly answer any question you may have.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes Mr. Epstein to testify.
Thank you for the honor of testifying before this committee. What I say today will shock many of you. My views on energy are indeed unconventional, but I hope you hear me out with an open mind, since we share the same goal, which is a flourishing and prosperous Puerto Rico. I want to make the case that the one thing that will most help the people of Puerto Rico lift themselves out of crushing poverty is the thing many of you believe should be eliminated, and that's low-cost, reliable fossil fuel energy. For just a brief moment, I'd like to ask all of you to close your eyes. I'd like you to imagine an ambitious young Puerto Rican woman. I'll call her Mia. Mia studied hard at the Emilio Delgado High School in Corozal. Mia's passion is artificial intelligence, and she dreams of working at a high-tech startup. Sadly, opportunities are sparse because many companies have fled Puerto Rico and many more avoid it due to high cost and unreliable energy. So Mia applies for a remote job at a Silicon Valley tech incubator, but during her interview, the electricity suddenly cuts out. The screen goes blank. She hopes it comes back quickly, but hours go by with no internet as she waits in the sweltering heat with no AC. Think of Mia's despair in those moments. Think of how much low-cost, reliable energy could have helped her when she needed it most. I know that every member of this committee shares the same goal I do, a healthy, prosperous, and flourishing Puerto Rico. In order to help millions of talented and passionate people like Mia, we must look carefully at the full context of facts about Puerto Rico's energy options. Here are three crucial facts that I almost never hear discussed about Puerto Rico, and I want to highlight this. So first, the percentage of Puerto Ricans currently living in poverty is 43%. Sorry for my smearing. Second, the cost of energy in Puerto Rico versus the states is up to 3 times higher. Third, the per capita income in Puerto Rico is $13,000. Honorable members, does it strike you as fair that someone earning $13,000 per year should be paying 3 times what you and I pay for the energy that powers our homes? I don't think that's fair. And I don't think you, I think you don't think it either. So what's the solution? Well, while we're told that solar and wind can provide low cost, reliable energy, nothing could be further from the truth. Because solar and wind are unreliable, they don't replace reliable power plants. They add to the cost of reliable power plants. The more wind and solar that grids use, the higher their electricity prices. German households have seen prices double in 20 years due to wasteful, unreliable solar and wind infrastructure. Their electricity prices are 3 times ours, which are already too high due to solar and wind. The only way for Puerto Rico to get low-cost, reliable electricity anytime soon is using low-cost, reliable fossil fuel energy sources like natural gas and coal, along with some massive regulatory reforms I discuss in my written testimony, such as scrapping the Jones Act. We owe it to the people of Puerto Rico to give them the full context, the benefits and drawbacks of all their options. This includes recognizing any real coal ash problems, but also recognizing that there are many solutions to coal ash used around the world that don't require shutting down power plants. Giving the people of Puerto Rico the full context also includes recognizing that fossil fuel CO2 emissions do impact climate, but it also includes being precise, not hysterical, about that impact. As I explain in my written testimony, there is climate change, but not a climate crisis, and certainly not one that justifies condemning generations of Puerto Ricans to endless poverty by denying them low-cost, reliable fossil fuel energy. The stakes could not be higher. I think about Eladia Davila, who was breathing with the help of a mechanical ventilator. During prolonged blackouts, her ventilator shut down, and tragically, she died. Her autopsy noted plainly that a ventilator, quote, does not work without power. Ladies and gentlemen, nothing works without power. Not the ventilators, not incubators, not farms, not schools, not the millions of brave and passionate people who want to provide for their families and live lives of dignity and opportunity. You have it in your power today to help Puerto Ricans gain the power, the low-cost, reliable power they need to escape crushing poverty. I hope that any of you who are interested in this mission will join me on a fact-finding trip to Puerto Rico in the coming weeks. We will have an honest, open discussion with Puerto Rican energy experts who are all too often left out of important policy discussions like this one. I would be honored to work with all of your offices, Democrat and Republican, to help the people of Puerto Rico flourish. I look forward to your questions and thank you again for the opportunity to share my perspective with you.
Thank you, Mr. Epstein. The chair now recognizes Ms. Santiago to testify.
Good morning, Chair Porter, Ranking Member Gosar, and members of the House Subcommittee on Oversight and other members of Congress. on behalf of the dozens of Puerto Rico and stateside groups that are joining in this testimony, we appreciate the opportunity to testify on the impacts of the retirement of the AES coal-fired power plant in Guayama, Puerto Rico. We have substantial concerns with both the impacts and the details surrounding the alleged retirement of the AES plant. AES's and Luma Energy's refusal to appear at this hearing shows that they act as if they are above the law. AES has a long history of non-compliance with environmental laws and regulations. AES's egregious handling of its coal ash waste and the polluting practices have contaminated part of the South Coast aquifer, the sole source of potable water for tens of thousands of people in Puerto Rico. The contamination continues as the AES plant site at the AES plant site, despite the mandate of the CCR rule, coal combustion residuals rule, that requires AES to eliminate the source of the contamination and restore the groundwater to its original condition. In addition to contaminating groundwater at and around the AES plant, approximately 2 million tons of AES coal ash has been used as sham fill at dozens of locations above the aquifer, mostly here in southeastern Puerto Rico. AES has shipped hundreds of thousands of tons of its coal ash waste to Florida, and most recently, a ship full of the coal combustion residuals capsized and spilled most of its cargo into the ocean in the vicinity of Atlantic Beach near Jacksonville. The Guayama region is an environmental justice community with high poverty and unemployment rates, where the majority of residents are Afro-Puerto Ricans. The toxic release inventory shows that the region has the highest contamination levels in Puerto Rico. The region has experienced a sharp decrease in medical services available to this environmental justice community, with the closure of two medical facilities and only one hospital currently in operation. AES has obtained permits based on fraudulent misrepresentations. AES knowingly submitted false information both as to the polluted water discharges and the generation capacity of its plant. The AES closure announcement is suspect. Government regulations in different jurisdictions where AES operates require AES to retire 5 gigawatts of coal-fired generation within 8 to 10 years. Experts note AES's heavy debt burden and question how AES would finance new projects. The recent actions of AES Jenner, which announced an agreement to sell some of its coal-fired plants in Chile, cast further doubts on AES's credibility. AES had previously committed to closing the plants before 2040, but instead is selling the plants to a company that is not part of the decarbonization agreement. AES is attempting to improve its image as a greener company, but Chilean civil society groups underscore the damage to the health of the population and the lack of reparations by AES. We urge the committee to procure the immediate closure of the AES coal-fired power plant in Guayama, prioritizing clean air, water, and soil, as well as the health of the environmental justice communities. We urge the establishment of a just transition plan with rapid deployment by PREPA of on-site or rooftop solar and storage. We ask for removal of the AES coal ash waste mountain and fill, as well as full cleanup of groundwater contaminated by the AES operation and decontamination of all areas impacted by the AES toxic coal ash. AES must assume responsibility for the damage to the public health and the environment from its operations. Considering AES's history of fraudulent practices, there should be an immediate suspension of all negotiations of any new contracts with AES, including its affiliated companies. We urge this committee, the federal government, and the Puerto Rican government to require PREPA to invest the FEMA funds allocated for the electric system to procure and deploy rooftop solar and battery systems and energy efficiency programs that will provide life-saving electric service to the residents of Puerto Rico. Multiple studies have shown the viability, reliability, and economic benefits of rooftop solar and storage in Puerto Rico. The We Want Sun proposal, endorsed by the groups joining in this testimony, vigorously promotes the transformation of the Puerto Rico electric system as a public service, including PREPA governance and the technology that empowers citizen participation to achieve resiliency to the more frequent and intense hurricanes brought on by the climate crisis. Because PREPA's transmission and distribution agreement with Luma Energy would perpetuate the operation of the AES coal-fired plant, we request that the committee include it as part of this inquiry. Thank you very much.
I thank the panel for their testimony. I ask unanimous consent to allow the following members to ask questions of the witnesses: Mr. Soto, Ms. Tlaib, Mr. Johnson of Tennessee, Ms. Ocasio-Cortez, Mr. Espiat, Mr. Tonko, and Mr. Price. Reminding the members that Committee Rule 3D imposes a 5-minute limit on questions, the chair will now recognize members for any questions they may wish to ask the witnesses. I now recognize the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Ocasio-Cortez, for 5 minutes.
Thank you so much, Chairwoman Porter, and thank you to all of our witnesses that are sharing their expert testimony here today. I wanted to just start off before I dive into our questions and really reiterate the disappointment with LUMA deciding not to testify today. You know, and the reasons that they cited for not refusing to testify before this congressional committee are, I believe, don't really hold water. You know, they stated that they won't testify because there are agencies that have to approve their actions. And they named the FOMB, the Fiscal Oversight Management Board, or for those of us on the island who know it, La Junta. Now, Ms. Santiago, is it fair to say that Wall Street has significant interests and influence over and interest influence and lobbying attempts over La Junta?
Yes, absolutely. What we're seeing is that the Federal Oversight Management Board actually was behind the hiring of the LUMA Energy after a huge lobbying by LUMA Energy, it definitely reflects how we've seen so many big corporations wanting to take over the electric system here in Puerto Rico.
Thank you. I apologize if I'm short. I just have to get through quite a few questions. And is it so we know that Wall Street has significant influence over La Junta, the FOMB, which according to LUMA Energy is why they're refusing to testify today. Would it be your assessment that the fossil fuel industry has significant influence, financial and political influence over this arrangement in both Wall Street interests and the politics of some of these decisions?
Absolutely, I totally agree with that statement.
Thank you. I apologize again, I just have to move on. You know, we've heard a lot about, and I want to clarify as well that Guayama, for folks who don't understand, is an Afro-Boricua community. That would be correct in saying that, right?
Absolutely, yes.
So there is layers of environmental racism and injustice. You have the environmental racism of the colonial status of the island, which makes it easier to subject to injustice. But then you also have that layered on the racial injustice of poisoning with coal ash, having this poison concentrated in a Black Afro-Boricua community on the island, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So to Dr. Jimenez, just to put a finer point on it, about 1 in 3 people in Guayama have been diagnosed with a respiratory disease, correct? Does this sound correct to you?
Señor Jimenez.
Okay, about 1 in every 4 have been diagnosed with cardiovascular disease. Is that correct?
That's correct also.
And the prevalence of urticaria is 7 times higher in Guayama as well?
Yes, 7 times higher than the rest of the island.
Okay, now I want to debunk some of this, some of this, I would say, Chicken Little arguments on how if we would close the coal plants, it would cause catastrophic effects for the energy supply on the island. Now, Ms. Santiago, Mr. Owen's testimony paints a very bleak picture of the electrical system if we close this power plant, except PREPA commissioned a report from Siemens, which is an energy contractor that has actually showed otherwise. To quote the report, I want to read to you the last sentence. And this is the same report that Mr. Owens has referred to in his testimony. It says, and the last sentence, no adverse impacts were identified on the transmission system with the retirement of AES coal. No adverse impacts, no reliability issues, no shortage of megawatts, no vulnerability to hurricanes. Now, Ms. Santiago, in addition to that Siemens study, what other evidence is there that AES can close tomorrow while keeping the lights on and preventing price increases on the island?
Right. Okay, so PREPA published a dashboard indicating that its generation capacity is at least 3,361 megawatts, and demand is down in the low 2000s. And so PREPA has excess generation capacity in the immediate term to address any retirement of the AES plant. That on the one hand. The other thing is that renewables, we know everywhere from Lazard to the studies that we mentioned that have been done about specifically Puerto Rico, rooftop solar on Puerto Rico, indicate that it's economically more beneficial and that it would provide life-saving energy access to people here for PREPA, especially to use the FEMA funds, the $9.6 billion in FEMA funds that have been allocated for the Puerto Rico electric system, and then some other funds that are available on the federal level as well, for PREPA to do a big project to acquire and install these systems on the rooftops, sprawling rooftops of the residences here and businesses as well. And that would be economically beneficial, more positive than continuing to import and spend billions of dollars on the import of fossil fuels.
So solar can replace the coal generation if we close the plant, correct?
Absolutely. The DOE study, National Renewable Lab study indicates that.
Time has expired. Thank you so much. I now recognize the ranking member of this subcommittee, the gentleman from Arizona, Mr. Gozar, for 5 minutes.
Thanks, Chairwoman. Mr. Rowan, thank you for joining us today. I think you provide valuable insight to the realities the Puerto Rican grid is facing. I want to start by asking you a simple question, and we kind of alluded to it in the previous individual's commentary. Is Puerto Rico's existing transmission and distribution and generation system ready to absorb the elimination of the AES plant?
First, let me start with the generation, and thank you for the question. The AES plant, as I indicated, is a base load power plant, which means that it's available 24/7. A renewable project is weather dependent. If the sun isn't shining and the wind isn't blowing, even with battery backup, it is not 24/7 power facility. So what you would need substantial renewable resources. You would need substantial battery backup. And you would also need something called a gas turbine to provide the reliability necessary to keep the lights on. That's very, very important. Moreover, your grid has got to be able to accommodate, to integrate those renewable resources. And right now, our grid is an old grid. Our power supply is old power supply. So the grid has got to be updated. It's got to be modernized. It's got to be digitized so that, in fact, you can integrate these resources and the operator of the grid can see what's occurring on that grid at all times. That's necessary for resiliency and it's necessary for reliability. So it's not a one-for-one substitution. You need substantial renewables, you need substantial battery backup, and you need gas turbines to provide resiliency as well.
So now, I mean, you bring up great points, and it's not that we're against, you know, renewables, it's just that you can't do it immediately. So now, if the renewable energy and battery sources could be constructed and integrated immediately, would the transmission and distribution be able to absorb the elimination of the AES plant then?
No, it would not. And that was the point that I was trying to make. The renewables will be located all across the island. That's what's contemplated. 3,750 megawatts renewables all across the island. The transmission grid would have to be redesigned. Okay. And one of the goals that we have is to create microgrids, 8 microgrids across the island. That requires major new investment in grid technologies. It requires major new investment in monitors and sensors. So at all times, you know what's happening on that grid so you can protect reliability and resiliency. So no, the current grid could not accommodate it. It requires tremendous new investment.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it. Now, Mr. Epstein, thank you again for joining us. I look forward to discussing the positive impacts fossil fuels have on our economy and the standard of living. To begin with, can you describe the benefits that affordable, reliable energy has for communities in general?
Sure. So energy is the industry that powers every other industry. The lower cost and more reliable energy is, the lower cost and more reliable everything is, and vice versa. And I just want to stress that Puerto Rico's energy situation is terrible. And one of the reasons I want to testify today is nobody is talking about that. They're talking about how do we maintain the status quo? The status quo is terrible in Puerto Rico. It desperately needs more low-cost, reliable energy. And just as one more comment, it doesn't seem like anybody here knows the actual facts. So I just want to stress, what percentage right now, I cannot believe, I mean, I'm really disappointed that Representative Ocasio-Cortez talks about shutting down the coal plant tomorrow. I don't know if anyone knows what percentage of renewables the whole island is. So it's 2.5%. I mean, this is so disappointing that we're talking about this so unseriously. So we really need to highlight the value of low cost, reliable energy and really talk about why Puerto Rico needs much more of it.
Yeah. So in your opinion, how will the Biden energy policies impact Puerto Rico?
I mean, they're going to make the U.S., the rest of the U.S., Puerto Rico. We're already seeing this. I'm in California. In my work, I had two things last year disrupted because of our blackouts here. We're seeing it in Texas. I don't mean to pick on Representative Ocasio-Cortez, but she tweeted the infrastructure's failures in Texas are quite literally what happens when you don't pursue a Green New Deal. No, in fact, plenty of places around the world can deal with hot and cold when they have enough reliable, resilient electricity. Texas defunded reliable, resilient electricity, including winterization, to pay tens of billions of dollars for unreliable solar and wind that don't work when you need them the most. This is really, you want to talk about existential threat? This energy policy is an existential threat to the U.S. And I mean, unbelievable. I mean, it would make Puerto Rico into truly a consistently third world country.
Well, and I did in my last comment, looking at the evaluation of the heavy metals exude into the environment, I find it very interesting that the majority is not looking at the catastrophic wildfires as an event that's second only to volcanic action and the polluting of heavy metals into the atmosphere, not only for pollution, but for health reasons as well. So I think that heresy exists there. And then last but not least, when you look at the battery storage, you have to consider the reclamation as well as the solar cells as being a toxic problem as well. So where's the reclamation? Where's the recycling possibility in regards to that? So I think there's a lot here to be unwound. And I think it's not a matter of if, it's just how they're going about this, doing it smart, doing it wisely. And as Mr. Owen said, you just don't jump on an old grid. You've got to update the grid to make sure that it's essential and efficacy to everybody.
What's being proposed in Puerto Rico is done by exactly zero places around the world.
Thank you. I apologize, but the gentleman's time has expired. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from New York, Ms. Velasquez.
The clock is. If I could ask the chair to please instruct members to mute their.
Pice is next, right?
Mm-hmm. That's what he said. I said it could be next.
This is the chair. We will reset the timer, please, to 5 minutes, and I will re-recognize Ms. Velasquez due to background noise.
I'll say, please.
Thank you, Chair Porter, for this important, for holding this important hearing on coal ash and the negative effect on the people of Puerto Rico. Let me just say, as a Puerto Rican member of this body, I don't need a cardboard to explain to me and to the members of this committee and to all the Puerto Rican witnesses in this hearing, the negative impact of coal ash on the health of the people of Puerto Rico. And we should not compromise cheap energy and expose the people of Puerto Rico to the negative effect of coal ash. If you ask those who live in Guayama, they will say there are ways to provide affordable, reliable energy, and it doesn't have to be coal ash. So let me start with Ms. Santiago. And I just need yes or no answers. In 2017, Puerto Rico passed a law restricting the disposal of coal ash in the island, correct?
Yes, that's correct.
However, this law allowed commercial applications of coal ash, correct?
Yes, it had a huge loophole for AES, so-called Agrimax.
And Agrimax is the commercial coal ash product made by AES, correct?
Yes, that's the name that AES gives to its coal ash waste.
And Agrimax is largely coal ash and water, correct?
Absolutely, yes.
Has Agrimax been shown to leach dangerous contaminants?
Oh yes, the University of Vanderbilt conducted studies that show the huge leaching potential of the heavy metals from the AES so-called Agrimax.
And do you believe that AES has been compliant with legal provisions regarding the disposal and storage of Agrimax?
No, absolutely not.
Okay. So putting this all together, despite legislative actions in Puerto Rico in 2017, AES continue to accumulate coal ash in its facilities, and it is not until recently that they began exporting it.
Yes.
If we all traveled to Guayama today, would we see an uncovered pile of coal ash?
There's still some pile. As we mentioned, AES is shipping the coal ash to Florida, to a landfill in Georgia, in Chester, Georgia, that's close to an environmental justice community there.
Thank you.
But there still is some coal ash.
Can you describe the significance of the South Coast aquifer in the region and the impacts that the AES coal plant have had on the aquifer?
Well, the South Coast aquifer spans from the municipality of Batillas all the way to Ponce, Peñuelas, and it's the sole source of potable water for everyone in the municipality of Salinas and everyone in the municipality of Santa Isabel, for many people in Guayama, Arroyo, and other municipalities. So in many places, it's the only source of potable water.
So we all like to talk about, you know, the recovery of Puerto Rico and rebuilding Puerto Rico, and it's important that we have reliable energy. So my question to you is, can you discuss the advantages of renewable energy in the recovery of Puerto Rico?
Absolutely, yes, thank you. So civil society groups here in Puerto Rico have a proposal called We Want Sun, and it's based on studies done more than a decade ago by the faculty at the University of Puerto Rico commissioned by the Energy Affairs Administration that shows that Puerto Rico has so much sprawling construction of what are called urbanizations and different cement construction, that it has a huge, what is known as, they coined it as a rooftop resource. And so their recommendation is the installation of photovoltaic solar equipment on rooftops to provide direct energy source and cut out transmission investments, which are hugely expensive. This is direct energy supply to residences, businesses, institutions in Puerto Rico. Studies done more recently show the viability of that option.
Thank you. Mr. Colon, ¿cómo se ha impactado las plantas y animales de la región?
Bueno, las plantas, o sea, antes veíamos el fruto de la planta, veíamos un fruto abundante, y ahora lo vemos cómo se ha deteriorado. Los cítricos no se dan, se siembran los árboles de cítricos y desaparecen, o sea, se mueren antes de y los que habían existentes que daban fruto, vimos cómo se deterioraron y murieron.
Gracias.
Mr. Colon, how did this affect the plants and the fauna in the area? Well, it affected the plants in the sense that some fruits didn't grow. A lot of the citruses, for example, did not just take. Any citruses trees that were planted, the tree just died. And the ones that already existed and had borne fruit stopped giving fruit anymore.
Thank you. I yield back.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Georgia, Mr. Heiss, for 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. Mr. Owens, we know that PREPA has a contract with the AES through the end of 2027. Can you walk us through the potential consequences for all Puerto Ricans in general, if we were to terminate that contract early?
Thank you for the question. As I've indicated earlier, the AES coal fire plant is a base load plant. What that means is that the plant is available 24/7. So if you shut the plant down and you don't have sufficient other units to supply the electricity, it causes major power interruptions. That is a major plant. It's our cheapest plant on the system today. So what we have for the resource plan is a way to move off of the AES coal fire plant after 2027. What we are doing today is we are investing in renewables, but we know those renewables will not be sufficient in the near term to replace the continuous supply of energy that we get from the AES plant. So consequences could be power interruptions, higher electricity rates for consumers, a lack of interest of businesses that want to locate into Puerto Rico, because they'll see that there's not sufficient energy supply to provide needs to keep the lights on, to keep their businesses operating. And the integrated resource plan that I spoke to looks at a way of evolving off of the coal fire plant, moving increasingly into renewables, but at the same time, protecting reliability, protecting resiliency, making sure the energy is affordable and making sure the energy is clean.
Thank you. That's pretty devastating to think about those kind of consequences. I mean, Puerto Rico already has many of the concerns that you've brought up, the blackouts and this type of thing. There's already energy problems with the grid. And if this contract were terminated early, it sounds like the problems would be exacerbated even more so. Mr. Epstein, let me go to you. In your testimony, you noted that the most promising step that can be taken to lower emissions long-term is the development of nuclear. Can you explain a little bit further why you believe nuclear energy is more effective and a good alternative energy choice?
Sure, and I wanna highlight, it is so wrong that when we talk about potential alternatives to fossil fuels, nuclear is ruled out. You saw with the proposal of the Green New Deal, there was anti-nuclear, is insistent on renewable, which in practice means solar and wind. Renewable mandates usually exclude hydro as well. And this is totally the wrong approach. If you're looking for low carbon alternatives, you have to be open to everything. And unfortunately, the world is so anti-nuclear today that we're shutting down record amounts of nuclear capacity this year, even though everyone claims to care about CO2 emissions. So the thing with nuclear is nuclear provides extremely reliable on-demand power. Every grid in the world that works has on-demand power. Solar and wind and batteries, that does not exist anywhere as the basis for a grid. It only exists as parasites on reliable on-demand power. So if you're concerned about coal ash, first of all, you need to do real scientific studies that are systematic, not just anecdotes and correlations and that kind of thing. But if there's a real problem, we know how to solve coal ash problems. There are lots of ways to do that. And if you don't want to use coal in a given location, use natural gas, use nuclear. But the idea of mandating these unreliable solar and wind that make energy more expensive wherever they're used, and then just manipulating data to ignore that fact, that is just absolutely devastating for Puerto Rico and anywhere else it's applied. And also, I'd highlight in my testimony, this is being encouraged around the world by the US. We're telling India to do this, Indonesia to do this, places in Africa to do this, to try to eliminate fossil fuels when that's what they need to make their lives better. I think that's really shameful, and I hope it stops.
Thank you. Madam Chair, I have one more question, but I don't see anywhere on here where I am on time. Do I have time for one more question?
Mr. Heiss, you have 22 seconds remaining on the timer, and I will, of course, allow the witness to finish answering any question you want to ask.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, Mr. Epstein, let me just go further with what you were just talking about. You mentioned the need to consider the full context. So as we assess Puerto Rico's energy generation, what are the factors that we should consider to understand the full context of the consequences that would stem from closing the AES coal plant?
Well, I mean, in general, we just need to recognize that fossil fuels are the only way for them to get low-cost, reliable energy for the foreseeable future. They need far more of it. And there are very clear, well-documented ways of using fossil fuels in clean and responsible ways. So the fact that there may be a problem with this particular plant, and again, that needs to be scientifically studied so you come with a solution, doesn't mean we should shut it down. It means we should deal with the problems there, but more broadly, get rid of all the bad regulations and limitations that are preventing Puerto Rico from having low-cost, reliable energy and flourishing.
Thank you very much. And thank you for helping me out, Madam Chair. With that, I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Heiss. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Johnson, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I hail from the state of Georgia. And I thank you for inviting me to this hearing, and I appreciate the opportunity to speak to the witnesses today. And I'm pleased to contribute to this committee's work, protecting our communities from coal ash and severe air pollution. The United States has made a conscious decision to pollute communities that don't matter, quote, Black, brown, minority, and poor communities. Not only does this subject disadvantaged communities to unsafe environments, it directly contributes to racial health disparities. For example, air pollution is a direct contributor to asthma or worsened asthma symptoms. In 2018, Black Americans were 10 times more likely to contract asthma than their white counterparts.
Mr. Johnson, this is the chair. We've lost your sound.
Okay, can you hear me now?
We can.
Okay, I'm sorry.
We lost you for about 30 seconds there.
Okay, thank you. Well, I'll just go into the fact that my home state of Georgia has 11 coal-fired power plants that collectively hold 90 million tons of toxic coal ash. That's enough to fill up 50 Major League Baseball stadiums, according to ProPublica. Dr. Jimenez, you described two different risks that airborne ash poses to anyone exposed. The first is inhaling chemicals like lead, arsenic, and mercury, which are toxic all by themselves. Isn't that correct?
Yes, that's correct.
And an often overlooked but equally damaging risk is the radiation contained in coal ash, which, when airborne, will enter the lungs. Why is exposure to radioactive material particularly damaging when inhaled?
Porque la exposición a estos contaminantes es dañino cuando.
Dr. Jimenez?
Because it may cause cancer to the lungs.
Now, how do the side effects from radiation and all of the other chemicals affect children?
Afectan niños.
Many children submitted to radiation early in their lives, about age third or fourth decade of life. Most of them develop thyroid cancer. Right, the thyroid cancer is related to exposure to radiation in their early life, and other type of cancers like leukemias, lymphomas are higher in children submitted to radiation.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Owens, I find it troubling that your testimony does not address the concerns of the community you serve. You do not address their health problems, the lack of viable disposal options, nor any other problems this plant has caused on the island. In fact, the only part of your testimony which addresses health concerns is when you state, quote, PREPA expects that AES complies with and will continue to comply with those laws as the PREPA AES power purchase and operating agreement requires, end quote. Why is it that you don't address the health issues in your testimony?
Because I haven't addressed the health issues in my testimony is no indication that I do not believe that there are health effects. My testimony also says very strongly that the AES has to be in compliance with environmental laws. The contract that we have with AES is one where we do not oversee the total operations of the plant. They have to be in compliance. Our contract says they've got to be in compliance. What I do stress very strongly in my statement is the need to move to clean energy, strong advocacy for clean energy, strong advocacy for complying with what the PREB, which is our regulator here in Puerto Rico, strongly suggests that we move, phase out coal and move increasingly to clean energy. That's renewable technologies and battery backup. So you admit
that the health concerns raised by those who do not want this coal ash in their communities are justified, correct?
I admit that coal does have pollutants. I also admit that we have to protect reliability, we have to protect resiliency, we have to make sure that the energy is affordable, we have to make sure that the customer is involved. So I admit all of those things. I admit that you've got to have a comprehensive plan. You've got to keep the lights on, you've got to make electricity affordable, and you've got to move increasingly towards clean energy. That's what I admit.
And we need to protect our people. And with that, I yield back, Madam Chair. Thank you for the time.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Utah, Mr. Moore, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Mr. Owens, I'd like to actually continue on with that exact topic point. And let's just discuss the concept of, are these mutually exclusive? Is investing in cleaner technology, is investing in making sure that we protect the health of those folks that this immediately affects, is and but still providing a affordable option for the timeline that's been set? Like, I'll just give you, I've got a whole bunch of questions here, but I'd love to just kind of hear your thoughts on the concept of, are these two things mutually exclusive?
I'll turn it over to you. Yes, you have, excuse me, Representative, you have to include all of those items. And I indicated, and I strongly believe that you have to balance all of those items. You have to balance reliability, you have to balance resiliency, you have to balance clean energy, and you have to balance affordability. All of those items need to be taken into account. So as an example, if you shut down a major facility that's providing reliable and affordable energy, it has consequences. If you run a facility that's not focused on the environment, it has consequences. So you have to look at all of these factors together as you move to a cleaner, more reliable, more resilient, and more affordable electric system.
I appreciate that. I'm involved in that in areas in my own district in northern Utah, northeastern Utah. There's similar timelines that have been set with some of our coal producing, and the community's engaged and they're willing to address all this. And if we overly go and mandate all of these different types of, you know, these excessive measures, we're only going to drive up the cost, making it more difficult for these communities to find ways to diversify not only their electric grid, not only their energy capability, but to continue to diversify their economy. And so I appreciate a balanced approach. And that's the voice that I've been trying to communicate to folks with respect to this and my involvement in anything climate, environment, and energy related, and will continue to do so. So I love that perspective. There, real quick, with respect to some of the hurricanes, Irma and Maria, what are your thoughts about closing the power plant early, given some of the issues that take place there with any potential natural disasters?
What the hurricanes indicated very strongly is that we have an outdated grid. They also indicated that we have outdated power supply. So you've got to reinforce the grid. In fact, there's a superb article in the Washington Today talking about grid infrastructure and the urgency and the need to invest more in the electric grid. And so that's also one of the key elements of the program that we have at PREPA to modernize our grid. And that's what a lot of the FEMA funding came in, because it acknowledged we need to harden the grid. We need to put better technologies. We need as well, if we're going to move to renewables, we need to be able to integrate those renewables. So a strong, resilient grid is a critical element of moving forward.
And with respect to that, anything with relation to energy storage, but what do you see, what do you expect to see developed in what time frame?
Energy storage today, centralized energy storage is basically lithium ion batteries. And traditional energy storage is 4-hour storage. So we need to have improvements in energy storage, but it's not a panacea. Just having a renewable and then having energy storage backup is not in and of itself sufficient. You may also need gas turbines in order to provide that additional resiliency. If you have a major storm and the storm extends for several days, your energy storage may not be available. In fact, it may not even be helpful, because you've got to recharge those batteries. And you have to have a source of electricity to do that.
Thank you, Mr. Owens. Mr. Epstein, I'll toss this over to you for just a last question. Any additional thoughts on that concept of, are these mutually exclusive? It's madness in my mind. Like, we can embrace these two concepts and approach that. I'll toss it over to you. You know, does Puerto Rico have affordable and reliable energy today if it's completely on renewable energy? And then anything else with respect to that concept of mutual exclusivity?
I mean, for me, I think of it a little bit differently, because I think the world just undervalues low-cost, reliable energy. Again, this is fundamental to human flourishing, and this is something where it's desperately needed around the world. Low-cost, reliable energy from fossil fuels, people here are talking about, they claim to care about life expectancy and health. It's driven down the rate of extreme poverty from over 40%, that's less than people making less than $2 a day, to less than 10% in my lifetime since 1980. So it's so important, yet billions of people lack it. We still have 4.5 billion people living under $10 a day. So my view is the world needs way more energy. And yes, fortunately, we have modern technology that can produce it more and more cleanly. But to just look at the side effects of fossil fuels and to not look at the benefits, you are condemning people to poverty, you're condemning them to suffering, you're condemning them to danger. And I want to just remind everyone, a natural environment is not a good environment. Nature doesn't give us a clean, healthy environment. It gives us a very dirty and unhealthy environment. And we need low-cost, reliable energy to make the world a very livable place. And those of us who benefit from that in the U.S. should really have sympathy for those in Puerto Rico, let alone the rest of the world, that's really, really poor. And we should be doing nothing to impede them from using the most cost-effective energy they can.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Tennessee, Mr. Cohen, for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Chairwoman Porter, and I thank you and the ranking member for today's hearing. As we've heard from our witnesses, and most of us more or less knew, coal ash is a toxic byproduct of coal plants filled with dangerous heavy metals and can become lodged in people's lungs and cause asthma, lung disease, or cancer. What's going on in Puerto Rico is awful. The Dominican Republic is awful. But it's also going on in Memphis, Tennessee, and in up in East Tennessee, where TVA has used carbon-filled coal plants to provide energy and have coal ash deposits in Memphis that they're going to try to remove over a 10-year period. They are, of course, in an African-American community where all of the toxic dump and waste goes in our country. They go to the least powerful, who can make the least resistance, and have historically had the lesser voices. And this is sad. We are trying to get the coal ash removed at the quickest possible manner from the Memphis coal plant, and in East Tennessee as well. So what's going on in Puerto Rico is awful. It's happening in our country as well. I'm concerned about Puerto Rico and the fact that they've even tried to market coal ash as a viable product. This year, I filed H.R. 2396, the Ensuring the Safe Disposal of Coal Ash, that will rectify some of the deficiencies in the 2015 coal ash rule. And I hope some of my fellow members would look at that. Some of the components, well, I'm not going to go into the components because my time's limited, but I would hope people look at signing on. I'm sorry to see that Luma Energy was not willing to testify today about its management of the grid. Mr. Owens, I've got a question for you, just yes or no series of questions. Are you aware of a lawsuit by the government of the Dominican Republic against AES over the health problems caused by exposure to coal ash that resulted in a settlement of $6 million? Yes or no?
No.
Well, you should have been. I am shocked that you don't. Are you aware of a settlement at all?
No.
Are you aware of a lawsuit?
No.
You're not aware of three lawsuits for tens of millions of dollars that the government of the Dominican Republic has brought against AES then?
I have not studied that. No, sir, I'm not.
Well, they exist. There have been three lawsuits, and there was a settlement that has reportedly resulted in a $6 million settlement. Do you know how much? Do you know how much coal ash was dumped in the Dominican Republic?
No, I do not.
Would it surprise you to hear 27,000 tons?
I appreciate receiving that information. Thank you.
Do you know roughly how much has been spread around Puerto Rico as fill dirt and otherwise dumped on the island?
No, sir, I do not.
There are public estimates that are reportedly accurate of 2 million tons. Are you not familiar with that?
No, sir.
I would submit and suggest that you need to have more staff or better staff, because these are disturbing figures that should be at the tip of your fingers and concern for the public in Dominican Republic and Puerto Rico and for their health. These are urgent matters, and it's horrifying of what's happened there and that the public has not been considered. I'm concerned about Tennessee. It's not exclusive to Puerto Rico and Dominican Republic. There was a big spill in East Tennessee, and that hasn't been cleaned up either. But coal ash is a danger, and it's apparently been spread around and distributed in Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic, not by acts of negligence or not by normal byproduct of energy production, but by attempts to sell, market, and profit from. The number is generally not known, but there's not a comprehensive list or map that's been made available to the people of Puerto Rico by AES, but estimates put it at 2 million tons of ash lining riverbeds and groundwater percolation basins, underlying housing developments, and blowing by daycares and schools. That's a lot more than 27,000 tons that I mentioned in the settlement. The sum was $6 million, but the 27,000 tons has been said to be there. The 2 million tons is to make you wonder about legal liabilities in Puerto Rico. With the ash being deposited in so many parts of the island, under buildings and riverbeds, it's not hard to picture the liability of the coal ash in Puerto Rico reaching well into the billions of dollars. Mr. Owens, for comparison, what was PREPA's total debt load when they declared they could no longer make debt payments and needed to enter into bankruptcy?
It's very substantial. I don't have the precise number, but it's substantial.
So the debt that sank PREPA financially was about, I understand, about $9 billion. Lawsuits in Puerto Rico against AES, which could be passed on to PREPA and its ratepayers, could easily reach into the billions. We've got a serious problem. I suggest each of you get better staff. Not each of you, but at least Mr. Owens, get staff, learn about these issues, and be concerned about the welfare of the people. I yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes the gentlelady from Michigan, Ms. Tlaib.
Thank you so much, Chairwoman Porter. For many of you on the panel, you may not know this, but we have the head bank CEOs and before a committee, another committee that I sit on, and I asked them, each of them, if they could define or did they understand the term environmental racism. Many of them, I think one said they vaguely familiar with it. I know in my district what environmental racism is because my residents and I live it every single day. We are forced to bear a disproportionate amount of our region's pollution. So when I hear about greedy, unaccountable corporate polluters In Puerto Rico, it is unfortunately a familiar story. When we talk about these economics, and I hear Mr. Owens is not fully familiar with the actual public harm that many of these decisions are made where profit is put before people. So Ms. Santiago, the damage to air, water, and wetlands and soil from the AEIS coal plant is the most egregious in the southeastern region of Puerto Rico. Can you just describe how this region, how it's really impacted the rest of the island?
Yes. So the AES power plant, a coal-fired power plant, is in southeastern Puerto Rico in the municipality of Guayama, and that's a region that's incorporated by, includes Salinas, the municipalities of Salinas and Arroyo, which are, most of its coal ash waste was buried in those three municipalities that I mentioned. But there were other some other 14 municipalities where AES coal ash was buried, in some instances also over the aquifer, the water supply of those other municipalities. Obviously, the communities that are closer have more impacts because of the air pollution, known as a hotspot in terms of the air emissions from the AES plant.
Yeah, this is extremely disturbing, Ms. Santiago. You know, I've spent a lot of time working on environmental justice issues. I have the most polluted zip code in the state of Michigan is in our backyard. And guess what? It's the predominantly Black neighborhood that is directly impacted by these decisions. You know, I see a huge red flag here when you hear about AES taking that coal ash off the island, which sounds like a step in the right direction. But in that experience, landfills in general, especially landfills that will accept waste like this for profit, tend to be located in communities of color. The Chesser Island landfill in Folkestone, Georgia is the only place that is still accepting coal ash. Is that correct, Santiago?
Yes. What we saw is that these last shipments from the AES plant in Guayama to Florida, to the Port of Jacksonville, and were taken to the landfill in Chesser Island in Georgia, and they are proximate, that landfill. The community, the environmental justice community there is like 53% people of color, both Black American and Puerto Rican or Latinx populations.
And you know, Ms. Santiago, I was so shocked to read that just this year, while transporting this toxic coal ash to Folkestone landfill, for instance, more than 9,000 tons of coal ash were spilled into the Atlantic Ocean and is sitting on the ocean floor near coastal communities, where immigrants and communities of color are most likely to rely on fishing or food for their families. And just for my colleagues on the committee, Folkestone is, you know, the rate of poverty there is like 42%. You know, the national average, y'all, is like, I think it's literally four times more than the national average. So, you know, I am really disturbed that many of these things are happening without a sense of, public outrage. There was nowhere for this toxic ash to go, and every turn it lands in the feet of communities of color. And, you know, Madam Chair, I really do appreciate this hearing. I think we need to have a hearing specifically about environmental racism, which is racial discrimination in environmental policies, and how that is directly connected to the decisions that these corporations are making, because they're given a green light to basically be able to do this to communities like mine and others, again, across the country. So, with that, I yield, and again, thank you so much for this hearing.
The chair now recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Espiat, for his questions.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair and Ranking Member Gozar. I would like to thank you for allowing me to speak today over this important oversight hearing. As a Dominican American, the first one in Congress, I appreciate the opportunity to share my perspective on the harms of coal ash in the DR. And this is very personal to me because coal ash has had such a long history, both in production through coal combustion at the Punta Catalina, a power plant near the capital of Santo Domingo, and its presence storage-wise in Arroyo Barril and Manzanillo. And of course, whether through production or storage, there's no good outcome related to coal ash. It leaches into the water and soil, contaminates potable water, flora and fauna, and the health impacts we have seen from coal ash in pregnant women and children born in and around coal ash storage and impoundments has literally harmed a generation of Dominican-born children with birth defects and conditions that are fatal. I hope that this can be a lesson that we can learn and act on to address. To any of the panelists here, the witnesses, I want to first ask, could they give me a very precise description of where the coal ash storage is in a place like Arroyo Barril in the Dominican Republic? I have some information regarding the illnesses in pregnant women and birth defects, but in terms of its magnitude, its impact, does anybody have any numbers regarding Arroyo Barril or Manzanillo in the DR in terms of the storage of coal ash? Anybody?
So I can offer some information. So starting in 2003-2004, AES contracted with a company called Silver Spot and others to take the coal ash waste from the AES plant here in Guayama to the Dominican Republic, as you mentioned, Arroyo Barril and Manzanillo. That coal ash waste was left on the beach, on the dock, totally exposed to the wind and the elements, also got into the seawater. And as you say, there were multiple cases brought first by the government of the Dominican Republic and then by individual plaintiffs whose children were, they alleged, born with deep birth defects because of the mother's exposure to the heavy metals and the toxic pollutants in the coal ash waste. That first case, as has been mentioned here, was settled for $6 million, but the individual plaintiffs brought a subsequent lawsuit in the Delaware courts that was settled for, we have heard in the media, something like $34 million. And AES was subsequently required to do the cleanup in that area. But as you note, there's a situation now with the Punta Catalina plant in Baní, Provincia Baní, that is generating coal ash waste in huge amounts as well. And we're working closely with communities and organizations there to address that situation.
Yeah, I have a comment on this. So I think you should be aware of this. I don't know if you are, but that the life expectancy in Dominican Republic in the last 60 years has increased by 20 years. And that non-coincidentally correlates with increased use of fossil fuels, including coal and above all oil. So if you care about the health of people in Dominican Republic, you should really be celebrating fossil fuels instead of just focusing on negative side effects.
I don't know how we can celebrate pouring
20 years more life should be celebrated.
Oh, that you has nothing to do with that. It has to do with the betterment of the healthcare system. It has to do with increased investment and taking care of people. It has
energy nothing, powers has, all of this.
Has nothing to do with oil, fossil fuels.
It has everything to. No, you should really. I'm happy to educate your office directly about this. It's very important.
This is my time. I may add that the Punta Catalina plant is mired in a corruption scandal with the Odebrecht corruption scandal stemming from Brazil for bribery, for overpricing of the projects, and a bunch of people are getting ready to go to jail. So maybe if you feel that fossil fuels are and oil are so productive, you know, you take a look at that, Mr. Epstein.
That's corruption. It doesn't change the fact that the fuel is good.
Don't interrupt me. Madam Chair, I yield back.
Thank you very much. The gentlelady now represents the gentleman. The chair now recognizes, excuse me, the gentleman from Illinois, Mr. Garcia, for 5 minutes. Yeah, we are having trouble hearing you. I think you may need to unmute yourself. Yeah, you may proceed.
Yes, Madam Chair, thank you again. Sorry for that glitch there. And of course, thanks to all the witnesses. There's no justification for allowing AES power plant to continue running and plaguing communities in Guayama, Puerto Rico. We already know the rates of asthma and cancer have increased since it began operating. This is a public health problem and a violation of human rights and environmental justice. Just 2 years ago, a Florida landfill stopped accepting AES's coal ash arriving from Puerto Rico after residents expressed health and environmental concerns. This would be unacceptable anywhere else, so why do we allow it to happen in Puerto Rico? We don't have to wait until 2027 to close down the AES power plant. The solution is within reach, starting with closing the plant down. We can and we should move towards renewable energy in Guayama and in other communities whose lives depend on it. Mr. Owens, your testimony leaves the impression that PREPA is doing its due diligence to bring concentrated solar power online. I'm glad to hear you stick to the importance of a competitive bidding process, but I noticed that you didn't mention rooftop solar as a source of new energy for the island. Installing rooftop solar panels would not only alleviate some of the problems with transmission and distribution of electricity, but it would generate cleaner electricity, making Puerto Rico residents more resilient against storms and reduce the island's reliance on imported fossil fuels. So, question for you. Are you aware that the Department of Energy has said that the potential generation capacity of rooftop solar in Puerto Rico is four times the residential demand for energy?
Well, if I might, Congressman, let me put it in context. I didn't explicitly mention rooftop solar, but rooftop solar, when we're soliciting for renewable energy, rooftop solar is a key part of that. Where an aggregator would take all the rooftop solar and it would feed into the grid. That's called a virtual power plant. So with some of the proposals that we received from this initial RFP that has been responded to, where there are 70 participants that have responded, a large portion of those are rooftop solar facilities, and we are strongly in support of rooftop solar, of virtual power plants being a part of this process as well, as a pathway to clean energy. So it's rooftop solar, it's individual centralized solar, it's battery backup. All of those technologies in the aggregate are going to be very, very helpful for us to achieve our clean energy goals, our 3750 megawatts of renewable technologies and 1500 megawatts of battery backup by 2025. Yes, rooftop solar is a key part of our decision making.
Okay, well, that's encouraging to hear. Why has PREPA chosen to allocate FEMA funds for new natural gas and not renewable energy and storage capacity? And does PREPA believe that FEMA funds cannot be used for rooftop solar?
It's very important that we, and when we look at reliability and we look at resiliency, that we really focus on those elements. So even if you have rooftop solar, even if you have battery backup, you need to make sure, because we know that renewables are weather dependent. We also know that energy storage is 4-hour storage. So you need something to provide additional resiliency, and that's called natural gas. So the Department of Energy and FEMA recognizes that if you want to keep the lights on, you want to have a resilient and reliable system, you can't ignore the use of combined cycle gas fired generation. And that's natural gas. So FEMA believes that that should be a vital part of moving towards a clean energy source, that you also need natural gas. You need turbines that can step in when there's not sufficient backup energy. The turbine is used as a backup supply as well.
Can you use FEMA funds for privately owned equipment?
The FEMA funds first were there to help us restore our electric grid so it can be more reliable and more resilient. Some FEMA funds were there as well to make sure that we have those peaking facilities that I made reference to. So for the peaking facilities, some FEMA funds can be used. Clearly for the grid, to harden the grid, to make it more reliable, to make it more resilient, that's a bulk of what the FEMA funds are dedicated to.
So could you develop a program where PREPA owns the solar systems and leases them to homeowners?
PREPA is getting out of the power supply business. The overall plan that we have, the integrated resource plan, which is approved by a regulator, suggests that we get out of the power supply business. That with we're using renewables, we let other developers come in, third party develop those renewables. Also existing generation, let a third party operate our existing generation. So we're gonna be out of the power supply business.
And before LUMA took over the grid, I understand there was a backlog of applications from families who wanted to buy solar panels for their homes. How big was that backlog? And how long did people have to wait in line for PREPA to approve their interconnection?
Well, you know, it's a complicated question that you're asking me. I'll try to be very simplistic in it. So what you want to do if you're connecting customers to the grid, you want to first make sure that that customer does not interrupt power supply for other customers. So that's why you do an interconnection study. That's why you try to quickly connect those customers, but you want to make sure that connecting those customers are not disruptive to the electric supply to other customers. So we have a process that we go through. We're seeking to expedite that process for interconnection, but we're always concerned about the implications on other customers, the implications of the rest of the grid.
Thank you, Mr. Owens. Thank you for your indulgence, Madam Chair. I yield back.
Thank you very much. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from New York, Mr. Tonko, for 5 minutes.
Madam Chair, can you hear me?
Sir.
You can. Okay, thank you, Madam Chair, for your leadership and for the opportunity to join the subcommittee's hearing today. We know that island life is often heavily dependent on clean groundwater supplies, and Puerto Rico is no exception. Sadly, we know groundwater contamination by coal ash is all too common. According to the industry's own data, 91% of coal ash ponds are contaminating groundwater. And this will only get worse with the previous administration's efforts to undermine EPA's 2015 coal ash rule. While at least tens of thousands of tons of coal ash have been deposited at multiple sites on the island, it appears that groundwater monitoring is only occurring in the area immediately surrounding the AES plant. The contamination plume under the plant appears to be moving slowly, as groundwater contamination plumes tend to do, away from the plant and, sadly, into the community. So, Mr. Colon, where do you and your neighbors get your water? Or should I direct this to Ms. Santiago or?
Señor Colon, ¿de dónde obtienen el agua usted y sus vecinos?
El agua se obtiene de los pozos, o sea, la autoridad de acueducto transfiere a los residentes agua de los pozos. Hay unos pozos hincados en el sector y se suplen agua de ahí.
From the wells, the authority of aqueducts just supplies the neighbors with a series of wells, and that's where we get our water from.
Thank you, Mr. Colon. And again, Mr. Colon, has anyone offered to test your well?
Gracias, señor Colon. Y de nuevo, ¿se ha ofrecido alguien a hacerle pruebas a su pozo?
La cuestión es, o sea, se ha negado, por lo menos el gobierno mismo se ha negado a permitir a las entidades que queremos hacerle una prueba directamente de los pozos de ellos y no se nos ha permitido, no nos han dado acceso a poder hacer una prueba, aunque nosotros pagásemos la prueba, no nos permite la autoridad, o sea, el gobierno, hacer la prueba directa. Esa es una de las preocupaciones de nosotros, que no sabemos lo que estamos consumiendo.
The government itself denied access for us and to the entities that we tried to give access so they could test the wells. And that's one of our main concerns, that we just don't know what we're consuming.
Wow. So, Mr. Colon, do you know of anyone else with a private well in your area that has gotten an offer from AES or PREPA to test their wells?
Señor Colon, ¿sabe usted de alguien en su zona que haya recibido una oferta de PREPA o de AES para hacerle una prueba al pozo?
No, por lo menos AES no lo ha hecho, no hay un acercamiento de parte de ellos hacia nosotros. El mismo gobierno que supuestamente nosotros entendemos que vele por nuestra salud, porque ellos no están afectando la salud. El gobierno que vele por la salud no lo ha hecho, no nos da la oportunidad de hacerlo. Imagínate ellos que prácticamente nos ven diferente.
No, we've never been approached by them. And even the government, who technically should be looking after our health, if they haven't done it, imagine what they would do.
Right. So, Mr. Colon, samples for metals like arsenic and boron and chromium and mercury are very expensive. To the best of my knowledge, sampling can cost hundreds of dollars. Do you think it is fair for you to pay to test your wells for these contaminants?
Señor Colón, hasta donde yo sé, hacer las pruebas de detección de arsenio, boro, mercurio y cadmio es muy caro. Creo que cuesta hasta cientos y cientos de dólares. ¿Usted cree que es justo que usted tenga que pagar ese dinero para hacer esas pruebas?
Sería injusto, pero como dice uno, estamos viendo, tú sabes, la gente enferma en la comunidad. Nosotros pues entendemos que si hay que buscar una organización o alguien que nos cubra la prueba, hay quien estaría dispuesto a hacerlo. Y por la salud, pues como dice uno, haría cualquier sacrificio por llegar a eso.
It would be unfair, and which is why we're trying, in the name of the sick people of our community, to find an organization, someone who would help us cover the cost. Because, you know, for health, you would just do anything.
Thank you, Mr. Colon and Ms. Santiago. I want to show you this picture of a stormwater retention basin in Salinas that was visited by committee staff while investigating the coal plant. These kinds of retention basins are designed to reduce rain runoff and allow the rainwater to percolate back into the aquifer to recharge it. This is usually a smart approach that reduces flooding and helps with clean drinking water supplies. However, this basin is lined with coal ash. It is one of the many well-hidden major ash deposits around the island that resulted from AES marketing the toxic ash as fill material. Instead of putting a liner under the ash to prevent groundwater contamination, the structure appears to be set up in a way that basically ensures that the groundwater is contaminated. So, Mr. Colon, last question. If the aquifer below your area is contaminated, what other water sources does the area have?
Señor Colón, si el acuífero que está justo debajo de su pozo está contaminado, ¿de qué otro sitio puede usted obtener el agua?
No hay alternativa, por lo menos para el agua de consumo, porque todos los residentes de ese sector, el agua, inclusive Pueblo Aledaño, Salinas, Santa Isabel, se sufren del acuífero del sur.
There's no alternative, I mean, at least for potable water, because all the people in my sector, people from Salinas, from Santa Catalina, they all get the water from this place.
Gracias, Mr. Colon and Ms. Santiago. Madam Chair, I yield back. I apologize for going over, but I thought it was important to show that slide. I yield back.
Thank you very much, Mr. Tonko, and we have allowed extra time for translation, so you were within your time. The chair now recognizes the gentleman from Florida, Mr. Soto, for 5 minutes. No, we can see you just fine. We just need you to unmute and we'll pause while you do so.
Yes, I am unmuted. Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm juggling through two committee hearings right now and meetings, so I apologize about the delay. Thank you for bringing up this amazing and important topic. We know we see the Western United States literally on fire right now. We see torrential rains in the Midwest, and we see increasing hurricanes in the Caribbean and facing my home state of Florida. And part of the solution is to get our utility system off of coal and use natural gas as bridge fuel as we boost renewable energy and options of nuclear as well, provided we could provide it safely. And Puerto Rico can't be left behind in this ongoing effort. In Central Florida and in my district, we know about the coal ash generated by AES on the island very well, because there was an effort to store some of it in our district. And we come from an area where we have many folks of Puerto Rican descent, like myself, both from the island and born on the mainland. And as we work on many things, this was one of them we didn't want. It was a huge local opposition to importing coal ash from Puerto Rico to Central Florida, and it was terminated early because of its lack of popularity. Why? Because folks in Osceola County think coal ash is dangerous. And in many ways it is. Our brothers and sisters in Puerto Rico should be treated no differently. And that means we need to use whatever efforts we can to get Puerto Rico beyond coal, to flow to renewable energy with natural gas as a bridge. We've heard this over and over and over again on the committee, and we really need to make sure we're utilizing all resources we can, whether it's in the American Jobs Plan and treating Puerto Rico equally, or whether it's with the funding we already passed after Hurricane Maria, nearly $2 billion to help upgrade the grid. That's where the real opportunity right now already exists, because that money is already flowing to Puerto Rico. Mr. Owens, you had indicated in your testimony that you're concerned that if you take AES offline, there's not enough renewable energy to replace it. We need to ensure that PREPA has a commitment to quickly bringing renewable energy online. I referenced this several billion dollars that you'll be getting that'll be flowing through LUMA, the company operating the grid. PREPA wrote a 10-year infrastructure plan for the use of FEMA funds, which has since been adopted by LUMA. Is that correct?
That's right. PREPA has a 10-year plan. That is really the integrated resource plan, which was prescribed to us by our regulator. And so LUMA is supposed to comply with that as well.
And Mr. Owens, is it true that there's no renewable or battery storage included in that funding? I know we're utilizing natural gas as a bridge, but is there anything for renewables or battery storage right now?
Yes, battery storage is a part of this process. The ultimate goal is by 2025 to have 3,750 megawatts of renewables and 1,500 megawatts of battery backup. So energy storage is a vital part of moving forward with renewables.
What about individual solar units, particularly for La Cordillera Central, for the rural areas that we visit town Toro Negro to where they had individual units just in case a hurricane hits? Are you all using this money to invest in some of these decentralized solar units for rural communities in Puerto Rico?
We recognize that there's a broader range of arrangements that will accommodate renewables. There's rooftop solar, which is a part of our procurement process. The rooftop solar facilities will be aggregated and then will feed into the grid. We call that a virtual power plant. There are individual renewable projects, which are centralized projects. There are individual storage projects, which are also feeding into our overall procurement process. So it's all of the above. There's no single approach. There are multiple approaches.
I can tell you the Puerto Rico legislature, as you know, is looking to get carbon net neutral by 2050. And I know Governor Pierluisi supports this ambitious goal.
Yes.
We really need to all work together to get there, and investing in renewables earlier is going to be key. With that, I yield back.
Much, Mr. Soto. The chair now recognizes herself for 5 minutes of questioning. Mr. Owens, who are the coal plant's customers?
The energy from the coal plants benefit all Puerto Ricans. It's integrated into our overall grid. It's a low-cost energy source. It's a reliable energy source. And the customers, the consumers of Puerto Rico, benefit from a lower-cost source of energy. They benefit from a continuous source of energy. So all customers of Puerto Rico benefit.
Okay, so the people of Puerto Rico broadly benefit from having access to electricity. And it's a point Mr. Epstein has made, that electricity is beneficial to people and to human life. Now, but I want to ask, who, just map this out a little bit, because there's a lot of acronyms here. Who runs the plant that we're talking about today, this coal ash plant? Who runs it?
This is owned by AES. We have a contract with AES, and we purchase the energy from that coal fire plant and it feeds into our overall electricity grid. The plant is owned by AES.
Okay, so they own it or they run it? I just want to be clear.
They own the plant.
AES owns the plant. Okay, yes. And then who runs the grid?
Today, LUMA runs the grid. Prior to June the 1st, PREPA ran the grid. But LUMA has a 15-year operating and maintenance agreement in order to run the grid, in order to maintain the grid, and in order to enhance the grid.
Okay, and then you are here today on behalf of PREPA. And what is your relationship with LUMA?
We are the owners of the grid. LUMA is an operator of the grid. We need to make sure for the citizens of Puerto Rico that the grid is well maintained and the grid is well operated. So we have oversight responsibilities.
Wonderful. And then PREPA has to get major decisions approved by some other regulators, including FCOB, which is on the fiscal side, and then the energy regulator, PREB. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay, so here we're trying to map out kind of who's in charge here, all right? And you're here today on behalf of PREPA. So I have a question. Can PREPA unilaterally close this coal ash plant without
sign-off? Absolutely. Thank you for the question. Absolutely not. We are subject to the FOMB. We're subject to the PREB. We're subject to Puerto Rican law. So we do not have the authority to shut down the plant. Absolutely okay. not.
So you're saying PREPA would have to go up here and, oops, that's a bad arrow. Let me just fix that. You would have to go up here and you would be subject to law. If you decided to close the plant, could you simply direct LUMA to shut it down?
We can't shut down the plant. We can't direct LUMA to do anything. We have to comply with the law, okay?
Okay,
and you and those agencies, I'm sorry.
So no, Mr. Owens, this is very, very helpful, and I want the committee and the American people to understand that. You have kindly come before the committee and you are helping us understand who has responsibility for this coal ash plant. So I just want to make sure I understood what you said. LUMA must be part of the decision to close this plant.
LUMA must comply with the Integrated Resource Plan, which is approved by the PREB, which is our regulator. LUMA cannot do anything on its own. LUMA has to comply with the law.
Okay.
LUMA's got
so
to
LUMA
comply
can't
with the regulator.
Act alone, but I wanted to ask the reverse question.
Yes.
And one of these entities, including you, decide to shut this plant down without LUMA's participation or consent or being part of the process?
LUMA's a part of the process because they operate the grid.
So what I'm driving at here, Mr. Owens, is we need LUMA to be here because they are part of the conversation. And as you know, we invited LUMA to testify because they're part of this conversation. They are part of this process. They agreed to testify. And then at the 11th hour, LUMA notified the committee that they would not be attending this hearing. And I just want to make sure the American people know what LUMA said. LUMA's senior director of government affairs said, quote, LUMA just doesn't have a role that is relevant to this hearing on this coal ash plant. But you have just explained to us, I believe correctly, that LUMA must be part of this decision-making process. It was LUMA's decision to commit to and then to withdraw from being present at this hearing. But it is my decision as chair of this subcommittee whether to pursue additional investigations. LUMA may not be here today, but they must answer to the American people. It was a mistake for them not to participate, but I am going to give them ample opportunity to rectify that mistake and to come answer questions that this committee has about the coal ash plant and its effect on the well-being of the people of Puerto Rico. With that, I yield back. I believe that concludes our hearing. There are no further witnesses at this time, no further members at this time. And so before we do officially wrap up, I want to take the opportunity to invite our witnesses to share any additional thoughts on the issues that we have discussed today. We're going to go in the same order that we went in as people offered their testimony. So we'll start with Mr. Colon. If there's anything else that you want to share that you think this committee or the American people need to know, you're welcome to share it at this time.
Señor Colón, si hay algo que usted quiera compartir con nosotros que cree que el pueblo estadounidense o este comité debería saber, por favor, adelante.
Lo último pues que me gustaría a mí sería que ustedes pudieran analizar la situación que estamos viviendo nosotros los guayameses y parte acá, y que pudieran hacer un análisis donde podemos determinar y que la fábrica CCR y que nosotros podemos vivir, tener una calidad de vida mejor de la que tenemos ahora en el momento.
I would like you to analyze the situation that we're living here in Guayama, conduct the necessary tests, and improve the life conditions. Thank you so much.
We can't hear you. Okay, great.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for sharing that, and thank you to our interpreter for her work today and making sure that we can all understand and hear from all of our witnesses. Mr. Owens, any final remarks you'd like to make? You're recognized at this time.
Thank you, Madam Chair, and thank all the committee members. Excellent questions. I want to again stress that in compliance with applicable laws and regulations, PREP is embarking on a very aggressive path to transform the Puerto Rico electric system to be more reliable, resilient, cleaner, affordable, and more customer-centric. Thank you for the opportunity today.
Thank you very much. Dr. Jimenez, any final remarks you'd like to offer?
Excuse me, I'm going to talk in Spanish right now.
Yes, please.
Okay. Yo entiendo que las consideraciones económicas no deben prevalecer sobre la salud de los habitantes de esta región. Yo como médico que llevo 45 años trabajando en esta región, he visto el deterioro de la salud de la gente y entiendo que es mucho más importante preservar la salud que las cuestiones económicas.
I understand the economic factors should never prevail upon the health of people. I've been a doctor in this region for over 45 years, and I've seen the health of these inhabitants deteriorate. I think health should never be second to economic concerns.
Thank you very much. Mr. Epstein, any final comments?
Yeah, I want to reemphasize that low cost, reliable energy is crucial to health and just give this full context of fact. So again, 43% of people in Puerto Rico are in poverty. They pay three times more for energy, $13,000 a year per capita income. 2.5% only is provided by renewables. So talking about shutting down a reliable plant is crazy. And then there are zero places in the world that are using the kind of unreliable and batteries placed scheme. And really crackpot scheme that people are talking about today. So I would really invite, I would welcome going on a fact-finding mission with many of you and helping educate you, some of you, about the different energy realities. And I think that we can see that there's a way to move forward with cleaner coal, natural gas, nuclear, instead of having this crazy dogma that we must rely on unreliable renewables. We should use the most cost-effective energy, and Puerto Rico needs far more of it, not less.
Ms. Santiago, any final remarks?
On behalf of the dozens of groups that signed on to the testimony that I've submitted, I would like to underscore that the groups are very clear that Puerto Rico has a golden opportunity before it. The PREPA and the government of Puerto Rico are being handed $9.6 billion plus other federal funds to invest in the electric system. PREPA's plan, and LUMA has adopted this plan, is to invest all of those funds, every penny, in either new gas-fired generation or transmission and distribution and mostly transmission, long distance, high voltage transmission. That is a trickle-down energy system. The 21st century now allows, there's technology that now allows countries and places and jurisdictions to have a more direct energy supply using on-site rooftop solar. The studies that have been done, for example, in Australia and other jurisdictions that are doing this very successfully should be an example, and that the funding available from the federal government should not be wasted and should not be invested in this trickle-down energy system that's very much a 20th century paradigm that LUMA Energy now wants to implement. And we should provide life-saving on-site rooftop solar plus storage, energy efficiency programs, energy literacy programs, and the whole gamut of alternatives there are to transform the electric supply here in Puerto Rico in a way that will save lives. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I want to thank everyone for their participation in this hearing. As chair, I think it's clear that we have heard from all of the witnesses today that everyone is in agreement that we want Puerto Rico to have a strong, stable energy supply, but it is also important that that energy supply not damage the health of the people of Puerto Rico when there are viable and appropriate alternatives. And PREPA's own study conducted by Siemens found that this coal ash plant, about which we heard significant testimony about very, very serious fatal health effects, including cancer, as well as respiratory disease, thyroid disease, and others, that there needs to be a plan to immediately use the resources available to Puerto Rico to close this plant and transition to an alternate source of energy. This plant could be closed today, according to PREPA's own study, according to their own research, without any significant loss of energy reliability or increase in costs for the people of Puerto Rico. So I look forward to hearing from LUMA, who chose not to attend this hearing, who withdrew from attending, because as we heard Mr. Owens testify on behalf of PREPA, LUMA must be part of this decision-making process. With that, I wanna again thank the witnesses for their time, for contributing their expertise and their perspectives. And I wanna thank all of the members for their questions. The members of this committee may have some additional questions for the witnesses, and we will ask that you respond to those in writing. Under Committee Rule 3.0, members of the committee must submit witness questions within 3 business days following this hearing, and the hearing record will be held open for 10 business days for these responses. If there is no further business, without objection, the subcommittee stands adjourned.